should be introduced, like, walk out. Yeah, that would be amazing.
There are more seats up front. Are there more people over there, Amy? Grabbing the last beers, yes. I support it. Well, I'm going to go ahead and get started. Come on up, Richard.
Oh, thank you.
Good evening, and welcome to our inaugural VCU Alumni Pitch Competition, you guys. My name is Leticia Taylor, and I serve as the Associate Director of Alumni Career Programs, and we're excited to have you all tonight. Before we begin tonight's festivities, we want to make sure that we highlight our partners, VCU Business Alumni Society and VCU Da Vinci Center. So thank you all for your support and help. We also wanted to recognize our sponsors, Activation Capital, Conventus, Startup Virginia, and Lighthouse Labs. Again, it would not be what it is without you all. And I also wanted to welcome and highlight a new member of our Office of Alumni Relations team, our new Assistant Vice President of Alumni Relations, Elizabeth Bass. If you all can just welcome her really quickly. A little fact here, this is Elizabeth's first week. All right, talk about Ring of Fire, the first week being homecoming. So you made it. This is the end. Alrighty, so just a few housekeeping points. The bar and hors d'oeuvres will be closed during the actual event, and we'll open back up after the award ceremony, so we can get back to the bar and hors d'oeuvres after that. Also, we do ask that you silence your cell phones during the pitch presentations so that we are respectful of our presenters. Alrighty? So without further ado, I would like to introduce our MC for the evening, Mr. Todd Knuckles. Todd Knuckles, class of 1999, School of Business, is co-founder and executive director of Lighthouse Labs, a three-time nationally ranked nonprofit that provides $20,000 to startups. Knuckles uses his expertise in technology to help aspiring entrepreneurs. And he consults with accelerators in Virginia to help shape the startup ecosystem in the Commonwealth. So please help me in welcoming VCU alumnus and ultimate Ram fan, Mr. Todd Knuckles.
What an amazing evening we have in store for all of you. Now realize this, May, as alumni, it is homecoming weekend at VCU. Get a shot up for homecoming weekend. Yeah. Woo! I can't think of a better way to celebrate all the VCU brings to its community as we all gather and learn about the innovation and the forward thinking of our founders as alumni and what they're doing to change communities literally around the world and in RBA as well. So it's a great event that we have planned for tonight, and we are excited that you are with us. We are also excited right over here. I believe you are looking live at 1717 Innovation Center, downtown in RVA, streaming over the alumni Facebook page. Shout out to my wife, who is out there checking out the stream this evening. So we're excited about that. She is also an alumni of our great institution, VCU, and our Rams did manage to pull out a win on homecoming weekend. I was not kidding the other night, but it's all good. So we're proud of them. So before I get into the details of what you're about to experience, which is going to literally be life-changing for people in the crowd and on the carpet up here tonight, we're going to introduce three fantastic people that have to make some important decisions tonight, our panel of judges. And I'm going to start because I know them all pretty well. They all are big fans of people who start things. They are people who start things themselves. And we'll start over here with Dr. Arnold Kim. Dr. Arnold Kim, as let's see, I got your graduation year here. School of Medicine class of 2000. It says you have two passions here, medicine and technology. But technology is ruling his life right now as he founded MacRumors.com. So if you've ever heard of that little site, about 15 million people visit it every month. And if you want the latest and greatest in Apple information, you need to go to MacBoomers.com. He is also a board member of Lighthouse Labs, and I thank you for that service as well. A mentor and a friend to many founders in our startup community. Let's welcome Arnold. The best for last. I'm gonna go over here.
I think it's smart.
Yeah, I think it's a good call. So we're gonna go with Richard Winch over here, native of Switzerland.
Right.
And a boring banker at JP Morgan for a little while until you decided to do exciting things here in Richmond, Virginia. 2002, it says.
Yes,
I did not know that. So joined Chamber RVA as Vice President of Leadership, Development, and Engagement, but he's near and dear to our hearts as he is the Executive Director of Startup Virginia, who is in this building with us alongside Lighthouse Labs every day, changing the lives of founders, connecting them to mentors, investors, resources. We're proud to welcome you as our judge tonight. Let's welcome Richard. Is everyone keeping up online? It's all good? All right, it's all good. Best for last.
Thanks, Todd.
Absolutely. Yep. So we have Becky Crump with us, and she is our resident creative, thoughtful, compassionate person on this team. And she's gonna bring some mindfulness to the group, shall we say?
Yes.
So that's good, because both Arnold and Richard will need that. Mm-hmm. So she brings with her a compassion and started a passion. She was in the School of Business class of 2007, it says, and founder of The Giving Wall. And if you're not familiar with The Giving Wall, it's where you can make the lives of other people, you can make a difference in the lives of other people by meeting their critical needs, by coming to the Giving Wall and sharing with those that have need in our community and hardworking people that need a little hand. So we would encourage you to go to Giving Wall and be a part of that community, as well as attend a Mindful Morning, which is a monthly series for people who want to make the world a better place. Who wants to make the world a better place? I hope we all do. Yes, Richard does, clearly. You want to make the world a better place in the back? Well, you can go and share that experience with others with Mindful Mornings and join our creative community. It is awesome. I've been there myself and appreciate her thoughtfulness, creativity, and entrepreneurship in our community. Let's welcome Becky Crump. All right, I think we have all of our contestants up here in the front row. Is that right? Perfect. You guys ready? Focused? Let's learn about what's going to happen here. It's going to go quick. We're going to be fast and furious. You're going to learn some amazing things, and we're going to change lives tonight. We are in the midst of a competition, and our judges have the distinct honor of not having to choose a winner, per se. Because, frankly, anyone who tries to start a business and change the life of another person through it is already a winner, right? For sure. But what we are going to do is hand out some cash. And we are going to have to make some decisions about who gets what when it all ends tonight. The good news is, once again, all winners. Everyone's walking away with cash. Fifth place, $250. Fourth, $500. A third, $750. Getting into the big dollars for second place, $1,000. And $2,500 to the winner, but it does not stop there. A grand prize winner will also be able to join the services of Startup Virginia for about 3 months and connect to mentors, investors, and friends in the startup community to help you on your journey. And every one of our teams, share of our partner, Coventus, will get technical service support, a project manager and a development team to help you on your way for some valued services there. So we're excited about those additional things that you will be taking away, as well as some cash, and look at that swaggy trophy. Someone's coming home with that. Check that out. You better have a brilliant idea, because there's a light bulb. We'll see what you do have. You may not realize this, but the School of Business at VCU traces its founding to 1937, and its graduates are still busy innovating with the latest technologies, as you can imagine. And we're going to welcome one of them as our first presenter this evening. It's David Waltenbaugh with Root VR. Let's learn how VR can help support better mental health. Welcome him.
I'm David from Root BR. When I was 17, I was diagnosed with generalized anxiety and major depression. But that doesn't make me unique. In fact, quite the opposite. Mental health disorders make up one of the largest and most costly classes of global illness, with half starting by age 14 and as many as half of adolescents struggling with their mental health. At Root VR, our mission is to make this half whole. And to do so, we built a platform of virtual reality-based mental health, mental therapy tools for adolescent mental health professionals. Thank you. Managing mental health is hard. It's mentally and emotionally challenging, even for adults, let alone for children who are just learning to understand their emotions and the world around them. It's also costly, with therapy requiring significant time and effort as both in and between sessions as children learn to manage and cope with their symptoms so they can ultimately heal and thrive. And finally, it's unpredictable. Crises don't make appointments, and our children's anxiety, depression, and trauma don't wait for the presence of a mental health professional to pay a visit. Root VR is using virtual reality headsets to deliver custom therapy experiences that are immersive and engaging, controlled and repeatable, and available on demand. Our interactive virtual environments incorporate therapy techniques like deep breathing, guided imagery, and positive affirmation to help kids learn skills that they'll be able to use for the rest of their lives. The underlying magic of our platform comes from better therapies, better therapists, and better access. Virtual reality technology is unprecedented in its potential, with research showing VR-delivered therapies to be more effective, faster, and longer lasting than their traditional counterparts. Additionally, we are empowering better therapists by providing them the tools that allow them to focus less on the process of their therapy and more on the people receiving their therapy. Better observing and responding to their clients' needs while getting amazing new insights through previously unavailable data and analytics. And finally, we're expanding therapy beyond the walls of the clinician's office by giving children and families access to the same powerful tools from home, school, or wherever they are through a VR-enabled smartphone app and off-the-shelf virtual reality headsets that are available at retailers worldwide. Our business-to-business platform is currently available through a monthly hardware-inclusive subscription model to private practice clinicians, youth and family service organizations, and schools and residential programs. And with Richmond as our test market, we're currently live or nearing launch with more than a dozen clinicians, organizations like Fostering Acadia and DePaul Community Resources, and schools and residential programs like UMFS's Child and Family Healing Center and Charterhouse School. The market for our platform is large and growing rapidly, with as many as 20 million adolescents in the US alone struggling with mental health disorders, and annual per child expenditures on mental health in excess of $2,000. And finally, already a $250 million industry, the market for virtual reality healthcare is expected to grow by 33% every year for the next decade. While there are a handful of companies like Root VR who are exploring commercial applications of VR and mental health, we're using an emergent technology in an emergent field, and we believe that Root VR is poised to be a market-leading provider of VR-based mental health services and therapies. I started Root VR 1 year ago in an effort to use my personal experience with anxiety and depression to help others find hope in a darkness I know all too well. Since then, I've been incredibly fortunate to build a team of research, clinical, and business advisors that includes some of the world's foremost leading experts in clinical and therapeutic applications of virtual reality. Over the next year, we're focused on growth, with plans to use proceeds from tonight's event and other sources of external funding to expand our customer and revenue base, build a team that will allow us to achieve our mission, and build amazing new content and therapies for our platform. But until then, you can find us here at Startup Virginia or follow us on major social media at Root VR. I'll be around for the rest of the evening to answer questions and provide a demo of our platform, and I'd love to speak with each of you. Thank you so much for your time tonight, and again, I'm David from Root VR, where we're building a future rooted in hope.
I mean, what a real pro. I mean, Power and AV, come on. Great stuff there. Going first, always the guinea pig, right?
Yeah,
a
bit.
But we're relaxed and we're ready for a few questions from our judges.
Relax.
Yeah. Come on. Join the carpet. It's relaxed. We're going to get a few questions from our judges, about 5 minutes, judges, a couple questions for you.
I want to understand more about the impact now. So are you testing with certain psychologists, psychiatrists? What are they reporting back to you? How's it going?
Yeah. So, I mean, we're still relatively early. We have two clinicians who are using the technology live in session. And it's been great. They are having clients who are coming back to them and telling them that they would like to come back just to use the technology alone. And we're also, we've had a pilot program running for about 8 weeks with Fostering Acadia, who provides services to foster children who have aged out of foster care. And they've been using the platform for about 8 weeks. They seem to love it. That's been great. We're about to hopefully start our first pilot program, larger scale pilot program with UMFS, which will be have six therapists, each of whom are focusing on six children. So between 3 and 4 dozen kids who they'll be using the technology in their sessions with their clients.
Awesome, thank you.
Another question?
David, good job. Thank you. Way to work through the AV. I just have a question around the pricing models. You mentioned several pilots going on. Like, what do you envision the way that you'll generate revenue for your company going forward?
Sure. Yeah. So we have a little bit of a two-tier model. We're focusing now primarily as a business-to-business model, and that's a monthly subscription, $250 that includes the hardware. And that is focused on clinicians who are going to be working basically with multiple patients. We also are sort of recognizing that there's an opportunity for some of the patients to want to use the services at home. So there's also the opportunity for people who may already have a virtual reality headset or a Google Cardboard to have basically like an at-home hardware on the inclusive model at $50.
So they will license essentially the hardware with the software with it?
Yes, correct. Yeah. Okay. So basically lease the hardware. And the software would be proprietary on top of it.
Like that.
Hey David, sorry. Good job.
Thank you.
So I just had questions about, like, you said that has there been efficacy studies on this sort of thing? Like, it seems like a new area that I wasn't sure.
Yeah, no, it does. So the technology's actually been around since the late 90s. It only recently became commercially viable through basically smartphone technology that's made it at a price point that is consumer friendly. Over the last 20 years, though, there's been a significant amount of research that's been done at major research institutions like MIT, USC, that has shown the technology to be safe and incredibly effective for treating things like phobia, post-traumatic stress disorder, social anxieties, and basically sort of the broad range of conditions that a lot of clients or clinicians that we're working with are treating.
One more question.
Have another one? Also, they're using this technology for intense chronic pain too, I think. So, question about the actual experience and who prescribes it.
Sure.
So, if you could talk to me a little bit about how long a child engages with, 5 minutes at a time over a period of 6 weeks, you prescribe that they do. How does that happen?
Yeah. So right now, it's mostly driven by the clinicians themselves. So the experiences that we're using right now are basically in-session experiences that are related to things like regulation, deep breathing, relaxation. Things that basically help the sessions go more smoothly, help the children enter a place where they feel safe and feel comfortable having the conversations. So it's basically being prescribed sort of by the clinician themselves, or used as an intervention by the clinicians. In a similar way that they've been using traditional talk therapy or written therapy-based interventions. It's just a more powerful option for some of those interventions.
Thank you.
Todd, can we finish with one question to every single one? What is one specific way that everyone in this room can help you?
So the answer is yes.
Yes.
So what is one way the room can help you?
Come talk to me. Let me hear your story. Let me hear a little bit about your thoughts on the platform, how we may be able to use it, how we may be able to improve it. I mean, right now, we are in a relatively early stage, but we are sort of constantly adapting and building this out. And the more data and input that we can get, I think the better product we can build.
Perfect.
So.
Good job.
Well done. Getting hot up here with these judges, some intense questions. Now everyone knows at least one question you'll be preparing the answer for. How can we help you? Great question from Richard. So you may not realize this, you may, I'm not sure, but VCU traces its founding to 1838 as the medical department of Hampton Sydney College, which became the Medical College of Virginia in 1854. And in 1968, the General Assembly merged that with the Richmond Professional Institute, RPI. Shout out to my dad, who's an alumni of RPI as well. So I don't think he's online, but well, who knows, the whole family may be. Founded in 1917, the RPI was founded in 1917, created Virginia Commonwealth University. So medicine is literally at the heart and foundation of what VCU does. And it is at the foundation of School of Pharmacy alumnus Dr. Nika Ojitalai.
Ojitalai?
You know, I practice like three times. Ojitalai. Who's using AI to assist in digital health with Healthy Quit. Let's welcome him.
Can I make one announcement too? If you have an empty seat beside you, do you mind waving your hand? There are some people over there that would love to sit down. There's plenty of empty seats, so now everybody's good back there? Great, I'm just trying to be the hostess with the mostest. That's all.
So thank you for having me. Good afternoon. My name is Yinka, and I'm the co-founder of Healthy Quit. We are a pharmacy and a digital company that provides vaping and smoking cessation. So as a pharmacist and a clinician, you come across moments that you feel like you haven't missed opportunity. And that's what happened when I met a patient who developed lung cancer secondary to smoking. What was challenging about that experience was that she just came back from planning a funeral. And looking at her profile, she could have benefited from real-time intervention based on her side effects. We ended the conversation on that day with her saying, "It is too late for me." That was a joke needed for me to start Healthy Quit to reduce the amount of people who have to say it is too late for them because of tobacco use. The other part of my story that my friend makes fun of me about is the fact that my wife is an interventional cardiologist. You can all imagine what our bedtime discussions are. She wouldn't stop talking about patients who end up on a cat table with a heart attack who are struggling with tobacco use. So like every other married man, I started Healthy Quit just to grow my wife once. And as the saying goes, a happy wife, happy life. It's no secret in society that smoking causes $178 billion in direct medical costs, 36.5 million smokers out there. And with the vaping epidemic, things are getting worse. And I'm referring to new vapors. It just doesn't make any sense with all the resources dedicated to tobacco use cessation that the quit rate is as low as 6%. When you really look at it upon research, there isn't a continuation of care approach that us clinicians understand actually works. And the reason for that is because of misaligned incentives. If you look at hospitals, for example, they have to ask, are you a tobacco smoker? They only use this method for heart failure, COPD, or infectious disease, because if a patient comes back in 30 days, it affects their bottom line. With tobacco cessation, you develop cancer 20, 30 years down the line, so no one really is incentivized to do anything about it. We're just not using continuation of care, we're also leveraging technology to amplify results. We're using the identified patient data, using predictive analytics. That gives us a modern form risk stratification, and we come with a customized plan for our patient based on that. That flows right over to our pharmacists, who vets the program, and also delivers medications right to patients' homes. This allows us to actually conduct medication adherence and also medication management. And as an added value, our app deals with behavioral modification. We do this through text affirmation, trigger avoidance using geolocation, and then finally trying to predict triggers ahead of time, monitor patient's heart rate, and also in agitation. And an AI chatbot that helps patients that are dealing with cravings how to actually manage those cravings. Here's our revenue and our business model, actually mirrors our pilot. So we're targeting self-insured employers, and also with our pharmacy, we can dispense them to replacement products and also concurrent medications that patients might be on. Premium services on our app, again, predicting triggers ahead of time We hope to charge $2.99 for those services. We do have competition on the market. A lot of those programs are informational, as I mentioned, very fragmented. A more direct competitor will be roaming, but this is not a core competency for them. They're not looking at vaping. And then to stay ahead of competition, we plan to address the entire behavioral health market as a whole, starting with opiate in about 6 to 7 months. Here's the team, Go Rams, got my doctor of pharmacy degree here. I met my co-founder at EO, I received an IMBA. He deals more with the sales and marketing and also the technology build. I stay more on the clinical side and also, business, and also the program development. Dr. Nicola is our physician advisor. Jess, who's actually the former digital officer at Bayer, is our digital advisor. And Robert Chao helps us with our legal advisor. We do have a machine learning expert that is helping us with our technology build. I'll be able to put him up by January 2020. We have a very small pilot running right now with a primary care physician in Massachusetts. We're actually converting this over to a clinical study. Also, we'll be working with self-insured employers sponsored by the state of Massachusetts. We are talking to Cigna Ventures, who wants to work with us on a value-based payment structure as opposed to a fee-for-service that you'll normally see. And then finally, we're working with Revity Life Insurance, who actually gets life insurance for patients who smoke, to help them quit and reduce premium. Here's our pilot. You can tell I'm exhausted. I'm completing my health law cadres accelerator. In about 6 months, we hope to actually, by June 2020, we hope to complete our pilot by then. And then just key takeaways. The reason why the quit rate is as low as 6%, I give you multiple examples, is misaligned incentives. Vaping is actually erasing all the progress that's been made in the past 30 years to reduce the amount of new smokers. What you can do for me today, well, I'm looking for health plan partners and also hospital partners as well. Thank you very much for your time.
Great work.
Thank you, sir.
Really impressive. Are you a full-time founder on this?
Yes, I am. And my partner is part-time.
Okay. I didn't 100% get the structure of what you're doing. Like, you just spend like 1 minute slowly talking about the app, and I'm guessing that is the tool you're selling to your partners.
No, so the app, sorry.
So there's two parts to this. So there's the technology piece, and there's also the clinical piece. So clinical piece, you come into our program, we come up with a customized plan for you, and we walk with you through the process. You leave with our app at home. Not only does the app allow us to actually track your progress, it also deals with behavioral modification. And then one of the cool things that happens is that when you use the chat, so for example, if you have any cravings or any triggers, you can talk on the chat and the chat will respond and tell you how you can deal with those cravings and work. And that's the part that we're building right now.
So you're building the app at the moment?
The beta version is done, but the chat part is being built.
So talk to me a little bit about the ways in which you're pulling in money. So you have potential health partners, no insurance companies. Do you have hospital systems? Do you have individuals as well?
We have a small hospital called Holy Family. So we're hoping to get a much larger health system. And also self-insured employers who we're working with on the next pilot in January 2020.
Okay, and then second question, apologies. I'm breaking
sure,
rules.
That's right.
Are you requiring that we're calling the patients, I assume, are you requiring that they input the data themselves?
No, they do not have to input the data themselves. Once they work with a treatment specialist, the treatment specialist can put in the data in. But on the app, it's going to be open to the public, so they can actually do that themselves. So where you track how much vaping or how much smoking, that's required the patient to do that.
That's more what I mean. So they would have to put in, I had a cigarette today,
exactly.
I vaped today 3 times, or
exactly.
I didn't.
Exactly.
Okay, and then that would prompt a series of replies or interventions.
That's correct.
Okay, great, thank you.
So you said you focus on vaping as well. I guess I was curious how you approach that and whether or not you get pushback from patients
Well, that's interesting. So I pitched to a group of insurance companies, and Philip Morris was in the room. They wanted to actually switch people. Sorry, from Philip Morris. I we're not taking a stance on vaping, as I have to mention that, but we're targeting more of like the new vapors and teenage vapors. So I'm going to say that. So there are people who believe that you can use vaping in place of combustion tobacco. But our target really are for new vapors, teenage vapors, and trying to get them off. But what's happening with vaping is that you're getting 3 to 5 times more nicotine. So we were connected with actually working with Cleveland Clinic on what approach that they're using. And then because you have to use actually higher nicotine replacement therapies to be able to deal with that. So it's actually been very difficult. So that's going to be part of our study. We'll be able to get actual numbers in a couple of months.
I think you can take a stance on vaping, right? Okay, so do you plan to go app only, or do you are you going to stick to the app and clinician and patient relationship as more a holistic way to solve for this really big issue?
We plan to do both. From my experience, that's what has worked. I actually started here in Richmond at Daily Planet Clinic, the free clinic, where we're able to provide continuation of care. And that's when I realized that actually our numbers were much better than the general public. So that's why we think that we definitely will do continuation of care plus the app to go to amplify so we get better results than the system.
So I want to ask you, you've said it, but I want to maybe give it in a more simple way.
Sure.
What does the app provide that the absence of the app doesn't?
Well, what the app provides is that basically people enjoy being able to be, I guess another way to put it is that when you work in a clinic, when a patient leaves, we also connect with you at home. So to continue the care at home, and not just when you go to the doctor's office. So we've just found that whenever you're able to connect with patients at home or have them take a more holistic approach to their care. So the best way to think about it is when you deal with diabetic patients, if you have them log in their numbers, we actually noticed that we have better results with those patients than those that actually do not track anything at home. So it makes them take a holistic approach towards their care. And that's what I've just noticed for me. I was a clinical pharmacist before becoming a director of pharmacy. That's what we actually noticed actually works.
So is the individual patient's experience in the app very unique because the clinician is then inputting information that delivers the patient something specific?
Exactly.
Okay. And do they have a platform through which they input?
Yes.
The clinician, and
yes.
That pumps right to the app.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Good job.
Thank you.
Thank
you.
Don't forget, his ask was connections to hospitals and people to use his program. We're going to make sure that gets in there. You know me, VCU Fast Facts up here. VCU now boasts more than 200 academic programs, and 40 of those in the College of Humanities and Sciences alone. And so we are welcoming an alum of the College of Humanities and Sciences, Lisa Mustard, as she finds a creative way to support talk therapists through continuing education with their continuing education through the therapy show with Lisa Mustard.
Want you all to know before I start. So I want to ask you guys a question. When you think about mandatory trainings, continuing education, and required meetings, what comes to mind? Just think about that. That's my problem. Okay, so a lot of people would say boring, uninspired, inconvenient, a waste of my valuable time, right? And I can relate to that a good bit. So when you think about podcasts, what comes to mind? So get that in your head. A lot of people would say fun, inspiring, convenient, can listen anywhere, right? Engaging, storytelling, all that fun stuff. So what if we could take the required trainings and continuing education and all of those boring things and add them to an engaging and fun platform like a podcast? All right, so imagine taking Joe Rogan, y'all know who he is, right? Okay, and Oprah Winfrey, their qualities, combining them together and creating a podcast for talk therapists. That is what I have done. The problem is licensed professional counselors, licensed marriage and family therapists, social workers, and of course psychologists, psychiatrists, and those as well, but I'm focusing on LPCs, LMFTs, and social workers. We are required every 2 years to have 40 hours of continuing education. And if you were to ask my peers, and I know I have one in the room right now, at least one, a lot of them would tell you they're a check the box, something that I have to get done to maintain my license, something that if I could find something free or low cost, I would jump onto it in a heartbeat. it's really difficult for us to leave our sessions that we, that's our time, you know, we, our time is a fee for service, to go and get in the car, drive to a hotel, really uncool, sit there for 6 hours, take in information from usually a really boring and uninspiring presenter, and check the box. So imagine if we could take just 1% of the LPCs and LMFTs and have them listen to a podcast that provided continuing education. That is my goal. My key demographic are those LPCs, talk therapists, LMFTs, social workers. Give them an entertaining and fun platform to get their CEUs covered. Every 2 years, we have to have 40 hours. 15 of those hours can be self-study. My podcasts qualify for CEU education for those talk therapists. It's entertaining and fun. If you were to listen to my show, you would, I hope you would say that it's entertaining and fun. I do discussion format where we have objectives that we cover, but it's a discussion format, it's interview style. I think it's pretty cool. Constantly evolving. Information in mental health is constantly evolving. And my peers want to know what the latest and greatest interventions are in treatment. Actually, when it comes down to talk therapists, the number one thing we want to know is what works. Sure, you can give me the history, you can give me all the research, but tell me what works for me and for my clients and for my patients. Constantly evolving. When I looked around the room at the last live session that I went to, the Low Country Mental Health in Charleston, South Carolina, there's a line in the sand. The old guard, the 55 plus, they're retiring, they're moving out. And I looked around that room and saw millennials and Gen Xers like me who are using social media and the power of modern technology to engage and connect, grow their practices, gain new clients, and also to acquire more education. It's convenient and affordable. The podcast itself, anybody can listen anytime. Anybody can get the value. If you decide that you like the information and you want to grab 1 hour of CEUs, it's $6.99. My goal is my downloads continue to grow. Excuse me. I just was approved from the state of South Carolina to be an umbrella provider of CEUs. The next thing I'm going after is the national certification. I have a variety of guests, everything from eating disorders to trauma in children. Grow a team, grow more revenue, of course, build relationships and collaborations with sponsors, and then expand into live webinars down the road. These are my steps, like I just said. Continue to create one CEU a month, charge $6.99. Continue to add value just by having podcasts on professional development with interesting speakers and topics. Get national certification, and then eventually move into live stream, where we can then get those live hours, which are gold for us counselors. So here's my focus. It's to be the number one podcast and live stream for talk therapy, CEU, and professional development. Thank you for your time.
Great job. So I know it's difficult to prove participating in these courses to get the CEUs. How do you support the therapist in proving that they had this experience with you?
So when you purchase the pod course, to get the 1 hour CEU, you have to pass a self-study quiz. You have to have completion in the study quiz to get your certificate of completion. Is that your question?
Yes, it is my question. I have a second one, do you mind? Well, I've got the microphone in my hands. I'm in a position of power. I imagine that you want to scale. I imagine you are kind of like the secret special sauce to the thing.
It's me.
Okay, so how, when you think about needing to get more talent to help you scale, what type of roles and responsibilities would they fill? And do you see your uniqueness as a barrier to scalability? So two questions.
I'll tell you, so my uniqueness to scalability right now is I still work a full-time job. So I'm not 100%, this is part-time, I do this part-time. So if I was full-time in it, my role would be to find the guests, to create the courses, to do the interviews, and then my goal is to hire somebody to do the show notes. I have an audio engineer, a website developer, all that stuff. So yes, I am my, to scale, I guess I would be the barrier. That's the question. Let me.
Yeah,
okay.
Yes, thank you.
I just have a great job, a cool, great job.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah. And thank you for what you do. Very quickly, and I think this microphone likes my accent because it's fine with Becky, but not me. Are there any, I know continuing education credits is very important, applies to many different industries. Are there other industries that are using podcasts to do that?
Yes, there are. And that's how I got this idea. As a friend of mine is a speech pathologist, and a year ago she said, hey, will you come on my show and talk about social media and how to use it and as a health professional? And I said, yeah, tell me about your show. And she told me, and I said, does your boss want to do talk therapist? Because we need this. And she said, no, we're going to stay on speech therapist. So I said, well, I'm going to do it. But yes, you can get podcasting, nursing, physical therapy, even medicine, as far as I know. That's all I know at this point. But it's coming. It's going to happen.
Oh, great job.
Thank you.
I guess in terms of scaling and growing, do you always see it as being a therapist-oriented show, or do you see your audience growing beyond, like, into just everyday people?
I do. I think that, well, if you were listening to my show, and if you're, what I say is, this is the perfect show for talk therapists to gain new skills, you know, insights, clinical knowledge, but if you're also interested in the field of talk therapy, then you should listen to this show, because I've had a lot of people who aren't therapists tell me that they gain a lot of value from it. But honestly, my niche is I want to help my peers grow their skills so they can help their clients. That's my ultimate goal.
Okay, at scale, it looks like you are going to have five webinars in charge, I guess, presumably. Aren't you eventually becoming sort of the more traditional
yes.
CME type?
Yeah, my goal right now is once I get the pod courses down, the self-study kind of, I wouldn't say passive income, but once that gets rolling, is to move into the live stream, because we can do live stream and that counts for in-person webinars. And so that's a higher value for a therapist. Right now, if you were to go to a six-hour CEU and sit in a hotel and listen to this, they're great. I gotta check the box too. I mean, it's about, you know, $200. So if I can bring that cost down for therapists and do it over a live stream on their lunch hour, oh yeah. They're gonna love it. I know. I love it. Yeah. And then was the general question?
No, I didn't.
But how
do
you guys
think
about me?
When you say $6.99, is it $6.99 or $699?
$6.99 for a long contact hour. And the way you can help me, the way everybody in the room can help me is you can go to my my podcast and you can subscribe, rate, and review, even if you're not a therapist. Mm-hmm. Oh, and if you have a therapist, please tell them about this show and tell them that it exists. I'd appreciate it.
I might add one more question. I'm so sorry. I keep doing this. I'm going to add, well, Richard did it, so now I want to do it too. But I'm really curious what people are going to do with the $2,500.
So for me, it's going to go into SEO. I need help with SEO. I need help with marketing. I am a great marketer individually. Like, I can network within my niche really well, but I got to get outside of them and I have to grow. I can get on other podcasts, that's not a problem. I need SEO ranking and help.
SEO.
Great,
yeah,
thank you. Good job.
Thank you. Awesome. Thank you so much. You know, Flinders.com is really good at SEO, but that's just a thing. Just saying. So, the number one public university for arts. And the School of Arts, we're proud of our arts at VCU, and we are welcoming an alumni of the School of Business and the School of Arts, as well as School of Social Work. We have both Kia Jordan and Alicia today getting together with Attune, changing the way we connect with therapists. Seems to be a theme here. Outstanding. Come on up. Give them a round of applause. Attune.
My name is Alicia Tete. I'm a licensed clinical social worker and the CEO of Get Attune.
Good evening. My name is Kia Jordan, and I am the lead marketing and brand strategist for Get Attune.
About 8 years ago, I sat in a classroom at Howard University studying to get my master's in social work. It was a requirement for all of us to attend therapy. This was my first time on the couch and my very first time understanding why I had butterflies in my stomach, sweaty palms, and could never, ever concentrate. Fast forward to today, I'm a licensed clinical social worker practicing in Charlotte, North Carolina, and people often reach out to me asking, how can I help them find a therapist?
So as it turns out, today I have all of these symptoms right now. For Alicia, she had to learn to cope with her anxiety. And for me, it is just learning to be more vulnerable.
Vulnerability, that's a thing, guys. Attune is a mobile app that helps provide on-demand access to therapists. I am really hoping to remove the barriers for folks just like yourself looking to find a clinician in your area. I'm also looking to create a platform for clinicians like myself who is looking to market our outpatient services.
So Attune was created by a therapist for therapists who have a therapist. We have identified two main problems. The first is accessibility. For users, they may not even know when to start or how to start. They say that this process can be overwhelming. How do I find someone that understands my needs? How do I find someone that I'm comfortable with, someone that looks like me, or even someone that may understand someone who looks like me? For providers, they might not even know where to begin to reach their target audience. The second is affordability. Again, for users, they may run into the issue of their insurance not covering their services. And for providers, these therapist databases are expensive. So if you're not advertising or marketing your services, then that leaves an entire pool of potential clients that have not been reached. Attune has developed three solutions to the aforementioned problems. The first is to address the stigma through custom confidential messaging. You don't have to worry about anybody seeing you walk into an office. You don't have to worry about anybody knowing who your therapist is. And quite frankly, this on-demand access provides almost a secondhand, seamless experience. The second saves both time and money for providers and users through a cost-effective digital platform. The last is to increase accessibility. And for users, we provide an interactive therapist profile where they can gain valuable information about the clinician's specialties and pick someone based on their needs.
Prior to creating the app back in February, I surveyed a test market of therapists, just asking them what held them back from marketing and what were some things that they need to put themselves out there. Some things that came up for them, they wanted to make sure that they targeted the people that they wanted. So I've worked for some of our competitors, and one thing about them is that they choose the therapist for you, and we're the opposite, where the person can choose the therapist. Also, as a clinician in practice, I know what it means for someone to come in and sit down and I never see them again. So we're hoping that by individuals being able to choose their clinician, we can increase retention for therapists.
So think of Attune as Tinder, but for therapists. So you may be familiar with some of our competitors. We have Talkspace, BetterHelp, and Therapist Directory, but only Attune checks all of these boxes. By offering an in-app messaging and text-based digital platform, on-demand access right at your fingertips, and it's cost-effective for both providers and for users.
My goal is to always make the app free for users. Again, I don't want to create more barriers for them, but our business model includes a three-tier plan. The therapist will pay a monthly cost to have their platform on the app.
In a little under just 1 year, guys, Attune has almost 1,000 users and has 12 subscribed therapists representing the Mid-Atlantic region.
Hopefully we can expand through other universities as well as local and community health systems. One of the things that we are asking for is, how do we reach a larger market? How do we get therapists to trust the mobile application? And then lastly, some mobile developers that we can connect with. We got someone covered in marketing and I'm the clinician, but we don't have that engineering component.
So next steps for us include, again, a confirmed investor, and that's why we're asking for the $2,500, validating security through HIPAA compliance and through mentorship. So go ahead, pull out your smartphones, pull up your camera, and download Get Attune.
Thank you.
Yes, okay, great job, y'all.
Thank you.
So I have so many, but I'm just going to start with one.
We can talk after, don't worry.
Do you mind? What's the vetting process for both therapist and patient?
So right now, this is a 1/2-person team. I am doing the background checks on the clinicians to make sure they are who they say they are. Each of us in every state, there's a licensing board and it's public information. So any of you guys can go and look up my name in North Carolina now. So that's I am a part of the process. As we get bigger, then we'll need to create a team.
Are they having to submit anything? You say you're like tender for therapy, so obviously I have to tell tender. I don't know from personal experience. Not that there's anything wrong with that. I also want to say that. But I assume that you have to put in some information about yourself.
Absolutely.
Maybe
so there's
like love, et cetera. Do they do that here both sides?
They do. Not the patient. So that relationship is between the patient and the therapist. The therapist has to submit an application. I have to review it, figure out that they are who they say they are prior to even being able to create the profile.
So how does the matching then happen? Because you're recommending, or are they just choosing? You're not saying, here's five, we see match for you. They just are deciding.
They're deciding. So the nice thing about it, like I said, I worked for Talkspace in the past, and the way that I got my clients was Talkspace said, these clients are yours. And I'm trying to change it and really encourage folks to make that connection on their own. And so it's like when you see the therapist, you can go to their website, you can message them, you can see their credentials and see, okay, this is someone that I may connect with, let me reach out to them. And you can reach out to them through the app.
Last question, currently, for now, are they able, they're having to venture outside of the app to the therapist's website to understand more about the therapist, or is that an in-app experience?
It's an in-app experience.
Okay. It's a good presentation, but I was curious, so two-sided marketplace, you're going to have therapists and customers.
It's hard.
Yeah, so the biggest challenge in any of that, I mean, you'll get therapists if you have customers, that's like the easy part,
mm-hmm.
but getting customers. So how did you get your 900 some, and then where do you see that coming from?
So it's been the opposite. It's been, I have had, because I also co-host a podcast, so there are people that know about the app, and they're downloading it, and they're messaging me, like, hey, do you have a therapist in Florida yet? Hey, do you have a therapist in Detroit yet? And so I'm doing still a whole lot of back end of looking up therapists until I can get them to trust to get on the app. So it's the opposite. I have more people searching, which makes sense based on the numbers that we've been presented already, just the vastness of the problem of mental health, and then I have less clinicians trusting that this is something that I can use to market myself.
I think you mentioned the two areas I was gonna, but two areas I would like to, HIPAA compliance,
yeah.
You mentioned that, I'd like for you to touch on that.
Absolutely.
And it's lacking a little bit of an app. Can you tell us what the app looks like? Is it what you've shown? Is it definitely?
Yeah, so you can actually go into the App Store now and download it. We are on pause with being able to get in. And so we're switching engineers. The engineer who built the app is not on the team. It was a contract situation. And so one of the things I'm looking for now is an engineer to help us continue to build. The first question, HIPAA compliance. So that's everybody's question, right? If I put my information in, who's gonna get it? Right now there's a secure messaging portion, and then we also wanna venture into telehealth. There's a woman in Charlotte that I have met with who has a telehealth component already, and so we're supposed to sit down and talk about how I can integrate that into the app for users. Thank you.
What do you need? Beyond technology, you just said.
Yeah,
what
I need
would
technology.
You like this, what can this room provide?
Come and ask me questions. Like, my mission in life is to decrease the stigma. If you have something going on with your medical health, you're going to go see a doctor. If your tooth breaks, you're going to go see a dentist. So I want you to come and talk to me about mental health, whether you can help with the app or not, because this is my purpose in life.
Perfect.
Thank you
so much.
So to have this right, we can license you through a podcast. We can connect you to a therapist over an app. And if you need an immersive VR experience to help you on your journey, we've got that too. So it's been a very productive evening for the therapy community. The other thing that I would mention is get excited, people, because there is a little surprise coming to everyone in the house after our last presenter this evening. In 2004, you know, I gotta bring it back to you. Our wonderful medical school, formerly VCV, for those of you who remember that, became officially VCU Health System in one VCU. And we hope that the clinicians that are now there will benefit from a unique handheld device that College of Engineering alumna Alex Ritchie will be bringing to the market with DuraSafe. Let's welcome her.
everyone. So at some point along the line, every woman expectant mother ends up asking herself the same central question. Do I want to do natural childbirth, or do I want to have an epidural? My mom was in the same boat with her first child, my oldest brother, Oliver, and like many women, she decided to have an epidural. Unfortunately, though, hers went horribly wrong. It was misplaced, making for a very stressful labor and delivery process that ultimately resulted in the loss of my brother. So as challenging and as terrifying as this may seem, it's actually way more common than we might think. Of the roughly 1 million births that occur in the United States each year, over 170,000 of these epidurals fail. So this ends up costing hospitals upwards of $2 billion annually as a result of things like extended hospital stays, additional equipment costs, and even additional procedures they have to try in order to attempt to reverse the failure. So what exactly is going on here? The truth is the procedure itself, the way it's done now, is extremely subjective. It requires the provider to rely solely on their sense of feel, in their hands, literally, in order to locate the space. As you can see in blue there, it's roughly the width of a single grain of rice, so it's very easy to miss. So what do we need to do? We have to make epidural insertion better. We have to make it safer for our patients. We owe it to all of those future mothers out there. So we need a piece of technology that will allow objective, real-time feedback in order to minimize these procedural complications. So with that, I'll go ahead and introduce myself. My name is Alex Ritchie, and our solution is DuraSafe. So as you all can see, our device is handheld, and it attaches conveniently onto the end of the epidural needle they use currently in practice. So it basically takes all the guesswork out of locating epidural space. So it's going to provide the clinician with a real-time alert. The screen will actually light up blue when they've reached the correct space for every patient every time. So unfortunately, it's not just expectant mothers that we have to worry about. You know, it's also patients receiving treatment in pain clinics or in surgery centers that also face these same risks, fear, and uncertainty with epidural. Fortunately for us, that gives plenty of opportunities for DuraSafe to impact patient care. So a quick look at our competition here. As you guys can see, you're looking at something called the Acuro and Milestone Compu Flow. Unfortunately though, these are pretty bulky pieces of technology. They're difficult to use, they're not super user friendly, they're costly, and aside from that, they're not saving the clinician any time. On top of that, the key distinguishing feature between us and these other pieces of technology is that these don't provide that real-time assurance, so they can't know for sure the clinician is in the correct space. So with that, we believe DuraSafe has the competitive advantage. So the way in which we're trying to make this dream a reality, we've tried to keep both the patient and the clinician at the center of everything we do so that we can ensure we have an adaptable and reliable solution from their perspective. We're also very lucky, very fortunate to be surrounded by professionals and experts in the field in order to help make sure we're doing things correctly. So Dr. Ben Ward is chair of our advisory board. He's a professor here within the College of Engineering. So I have the opportunity to work closely with him and our clinical, engineering, and entrepreneurial partners from here in Richmond and across the East Coast. We also have a founder-based team here locally in Richmond with different skill sets that kind of work to keep us on our toes and moving forward efficiently. So quick look at our plan. We started about a year ago, feels like much longer than that. We've had the opportunity to undergo two accelerators here at VCU, which has been instrumental for our business model development. I'm so excited to share with you guys live in person tonight, we achieved a long anticipated milestone a couple weeks ago. We did cadaver testing for the first time. So we got to experience the device in human tissue, which was incredibly exciting and promising for all of us. So looking ahead, we have much more testing to do, and that really is where our need resides. So a quick look over the next couple of years for us, our priority is really going to be on more robust device testing, as well as safety and sterility testing. Aside from that, we have filed our PCT, so we're looking at intellectual property related expenses in addition to compliance expenses as we pursue a Class 1 regulatory pathway for DuraSafe. So, you know, in terms of how we want to engage with you all, there are so many opportunities to work with us. We are always looking for mentorship, strategy development ideas, fundraising ideas, and of course, to anything on the tissue engineering front would be super helpful for us. So with that, I just want to thank you guys. It's an absolute honor to be here with you all tonight, share a little bit of our vision and our story, and look forward to engaging with you guys. Thank you.
Obviously, the testing is important, and you know, once you get there, I think it seems like an easy sell. So, how did you come up with the engineering of it? Like, where did that come from? I guess obviously, you know, you have a problem, but then it's another step to actually get there.
Yeah, so that's a great question. I love this question because it's been a unique journey. So we actually started working on the engineering aspect of this almost 3 years ago. So a vast majority of our time has been spent success, failure, you know, just trial and error, going through different design iterations. So for a while, we didn't know what the tech would look like. At first we tried to change the needle, which didn't work for obvious reasons. So we went through a lot of just testing on watermelons and cantaloupes, because that's kind of replicative of a human spine. So the engineering aspect of this took a long time to develop, but each of us have engineering backgrounds, so biomedical engineering, which came in handy. We did have to outsource some coders and, the tech side of things. So the engineering side is something we focused on for almost 2 years before we even dove into the business side.
And real quickly, have you gotten any feedback from potential customers, hospital systems, that sort of thing?
Absolutely. So we're really lucky. Dr. Nikki D'Amico, she's chair of nursing anesthesia here for VCU Health. She's one of our key advisors. So she's given us access to clinicians and students to do focus groups and even do simulator model testing within the hospital. So that's been absolutely instrumental, getting feedback and shaping the value proposition. As clinicians that have shaped what the device looks like now, we originally had a very different idea, but it's their feedback that's brought us to where we are today. So yeah, VCU Health has been key to everything.
I just want to talk a little bit about this idea of it being an easy sell and also get more specific on your customers in particular. So who are they, or who would they you ideally like them to be? And then talk to me a little bit more about the severity of their own pain that this will solve for.
Okay, so I'll do the first part of that question. So, the customer segment portion of our company is sort of interesting. It's dynamic because not only do we have to make a compelling case to the hospital, right, to purchasing committees who make decisions to use technology, we also have to get clinician buy-in. So a lot of it is newer clinicians that really struggle to get the hang of doing an epidural. So they're all over this device. They're so excited about something that could help mitigate that risk. Then at the same time, it's patients. It's you all. It's you guys, your moms, your sisters, anyone not even, female, just someone getting an epidural for pain management. It's patients that you all that have to buy into this as well. Because at the end of the day, if the patient opts in to use the, previous method, our device wouldn't be successful without that. So
you're pre-revenue now, obviously. When do you anticipate that changing?
That's a good question. So we've raised $15,000 to date, which has been key for us to be able to do our device testing, and marketing and things like that. I anticipate it being within the next 5 to 10 years. The device testing for something like this is robust, it's extensive. So even for this being class one, which is the most minimal pathway to go through the FDA, it still takes years and lots of testing and fundraising. So long road ahead, but we're excited. And then the pain question, just real quick, I know we're short on time. So my mom, she had failed epidural. She's still in pain where they went through her and punctured her dura. So essentially what ends up happening is if they give a bad enough location, like if they don't locate the space, if they're so off, they can puncture your dura, which is where your spinal fluid is located. So it'll actually come back out as they're trying to put stuff into your back. So it's a traumatic experience, and you can have nerve damage permanently.
I just have a. Have you done any research on any idea of what you think is going to cost and how easy it is to distribute? Any research on that? And I understand you're pre, but I'm just curious.
Yeah, no, it's a great question. So in terms of how we would get this out there, so there are a couple of big players. There's McKesson and Owens & Minor. They primarily have the market right now on the epidural kits. So the idea is that this would be sold as sort of an add-on to the kit. So that's kind of what keeps us in the class one space, because it wouldn't be in conjunction with the needle, which makes it more complicated. So anyway, this would be an add-on in theory, and we would like to be able to use their already existing distribution and manufacturing networks in order to push this out to the health systems that they interact with. And then from a cost standpoint, those other solutions that I had up, they use ultrasound, so it's more expensive. So roughly what they're looking at between $10,000 and $12,000 for each model that they sell, and monthly maintenance fees, so we wouldn't have those. So we have disposable and sterilizable options, which kind of minimizes that month-to-month maintenance cost. And from our standpoint, we're looking somewhere at this point, we think between $1,200 and $1,500 per unit. Definitely subject to change, but more competitive comparison to the others.
What do you need from the room, real quick?
I need to hear your stories. I need you guys to be vocal. So if something goes wrong, tell your providers, tell people, engage with the process. That's what's going to help shape this change.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you. All righty. Tough decision, guys. Are you guys ready to make it?
No.
So they're going to escort our judges out to make the decision who is going to get the badge. All of our banners and winners, I am certainly proud to be a part of Rand Nation this evening. And now it's your turn to get involved. I teased this out before the last group. Do you have a favorite? Do you have a favorite in your mind right now? Think. Get your phone out while you're thinking about your favorite. Because it is crowd favorite time at VCU Alumni Pitch Competition, the first inaugural event. Get out your phone, text the code to 37607. Text code to 37607.
We got one person on random. You're not going to see the results on here.
We won't see your vote.
We're
tabulating. You're going to let two people make this decision? I don't think so. There should be at least...
Seven.
But
it should be at least 70.
We have a tune at 102.28. We have...
DuraSafe
at 377. Virtual reality, 1084.27. For a 9:30 show, 103, and then 103.412. I'll be quick. Can everyone see that? Yeah, get up. Come see it. Check it out. You're texting that to 37607. Oh, decisions. Da, da, da. Da, da, da. Take it off the screen if you're tabulating. I don't know what's happening. That's all I do.
Yeah, you're good.
So everyone proud of how you did. Unbelievable group up here.
We do Let's have give a them
one more big round of applause. Favorites, judges' choices do not define your destiny or your future. Right? You can chart that, and every one of you will be successful for the journey. So we thank you for your time and dedication to your craft. We do hope it goes your way this evening, but if not, Ram Nation still has your back as your alumni, right?
Yes.
Absolutely.
Well,
so let's
get
it.
All right, drum roll, please, for our fan favorite award with this lovely fan favorite pack. It is DuraSafe.
Shot straight up. Yeah? Oh, we did! I'm picking on you, but okay, what are you about? Super quick.
Right.
Not both things. Like one thing.
One thing. Okay.
One thing.
Alright. So my company is Family Beer Robotics, and I'm doing this as Linebird. I've invented a technology that allows drones to take contact measurements of power transmission lines. So instead of having linemen up there dangling from helicopters 100 feet in the air next to half a million volts, you can have a drone do it instead.
Second thing, consummate inventor.
All right,
So second thing is working on a VCU spin-off technology enabling cold, secure storage of pharmaceuticals in the hospital. So automated dispensing cabinets are used to securely dispense medicines at room temperature in the hospital and other healthcare environments, but there's no refrigerated equivalent. So medicines get stored room temperature and expire much quicker, or they have less security than their non-refrigerated counterparts and no inventory control. So that's what problem we're trying to solve there with CCARS, which is a long acronym for Secure Compartmentalized Automated Refrigerated Storage.
Phew, that's an outcome. Good job. Lionbird is actually a video on that online, right? You can go check out Lionbird if you look at it.
It was in the RTV too.
Terrific. More? You're done now. Okay, so we have other founders in the house, surely. I mean, I know one. I sense one. Oh, here we go. You want to share your story?
Sure.
Pop up. Yep. 30 seconds.
Hi everyone, my name is Daryl Schneider. I created ProM Sports, which is a social networking site for athletes and sports. So if you are an athlete, you can fill out a profile. Then after that, that allows you to find other athletes in those sports in your communities. You travel to a new city, I need to find a tennis partner. That's where you can find them. And it just goes from there.
I do need a tennis partner, so that sounds exciting. What was it again? Is it live?
It is live.
Okay, well,
ProAm Sports.
ProAm Sports. .com. Got it. Nailed it. All right, going to the back. Another founder anxious to share 30 seconds of life changing material right here. Stand up.
My name is Jeanine Michelle. I with my sister, we design spaces, whether it's like architecture, interiors, or physical spaces on the page.
Beautiful. Do you need a space design? Right here, right? Got it. Perfect. All right. Yeah. Literally one of my favorite founders on the planet. And I mean that. I knew I was going to eventually get back here. You would have to pitch something. But here we go with Jeff Beck, a proud alumni, not only of VCU, but of Lighthouse Labs as well. And we are super proud of you. What are you doing right now?
So my name is Jeff Beck. I'm the CEO and co-founder of Answers Now. We're a platform that supports parents of children on the autism spectrum by pairing them with certified experts over our mobile platform. And this is awesome. Todd's awesome. Lighthouse is awesome. So check them out. If you know anybody who's a founder, absolutely plug Lighthouse, one of the best accelerators in the country. So thanks to Todd for being here.
He didn't plan that part, but he's pretty good. You want to pop up and share? Okay, the judges are back, so quickly.
I'm Loretta Wilcox, I'm a robot to make natural skincare products, and this is a pain reliever, all essential oils, and I also make a cream for pain.
Awesome. Pain reliever products. Oh my gosh, 30 more seconds. Are you going to do it?
Right.
Come on, quick.
All right, so I'm trying to start a food forest, which is an edible medicinal garden that people can learn how to work with the natural environment and, you know, eat healthy.
All right, that's pretty cool. Now, we just finished accelerating a company that does basically hydroponics. It's like farm on a shelf, and it's all monitored in real time. Could turn anyone into a hydroponics expert, grow your own lettuce, whatever. They put it in restaurants. Maybe they can do some medicinal gardening, too. Do we have a decision, Becky?
Just so we know things.
We know things. Let's share things so we can get to the food and drink, all right? Sound like good, huh?
Yeah.
All right. Good. Please.
Okay, so we're starting with 5 and working to 1. This was a very difficult decision, and true to form, it's kind of the theme of the night, is this like pressure cooker environment. We had about 90 seconds and then asked for another minute to decide. But great job to everybody. We thought you were all really wonderful. It's really anxiety provoking to get up in front of people and then to also get up in front of people and talk about your passion. So great job, thanks for being here, especially those who traveled, thanks for traveling. Without further delay, the decision. In 5th place, everybody's winner today, so that's exciting too. Yeah, good. 5th place, Healthy Quit. Great job, thank you so much. 4th, Attune.
$500.
$250 and $500.
500. Thank you very much. What's third place money?
750.
Therapy show. Second place money, sir?
1,000.
Okay.
You kind of already will note also the grand prize.
Yeah, it's going to be a 2-1 deal here as soon as you reveal it.
What's first place money?
2,500.
Okay. So second place, you're safe.
Here's Ruth Dion. One more round of applause for our grand champion. One more round of applause for our judges. Tough decision. And finally, our friends at Lighthouse, Activation Capital Startup, and Convinces. One more round of applause for those. Let's join each other's company with networking. If you're a finalist, we have some pictures to take, so you come up here and everyone else can enjoy yourself this evening. Thank you for coming to the first ever alumni pitch.